Welcome to the Spiritual Fortitude Podcast. This episode is Christ Born of Woman by Father George Reynolds. God bless and enjoy.
This coming April 2013 will be my 30th anniversary of my first coming into the church. And about 2 years ago, two years before, I made my first Mass, which was on the Feast of Our Lady's Assumption. And it was at that Mass when I was 16 years of age that I knew that Jesus was truly present in the Holy Eucharist and that Mary was truly the Mother of God. And it happened at my first Mass, and it's never left me. It's been a great gift to me that I'm grateful that I can see Christ and the fullness of Christ through his Mother, and that you do not have to choose between Jesus and Mary. They come together. You know, I've always thinking about people thinking about making us make choices. I've never seen one man who isn't a mama's boy. And I would like to see any man's wife saying it's either me or your mother. And how that will work out. The reason for this title comes from the fourth chapter of St. Paul's letter to the Galatians. And it deals with what Christ was called to be. As we know, our first parents were created to have an intimate love relationship with the fullness of God. God is never in outside of relationship. The Trinity is a communion of persons in one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So God is a God of relationship. God creates in relationship. So humanity was created to have that full relationship of honoring, loving, and knowing God and journeying with God to the call of eternal life. So Adam and Eve were never meant to be the first nudists to live perpetually naked and be vegetarians. We've heard that. We think that sometimes. You think that's paradise. Not having to worry about clothes, getting to eat all those nice vegetables, having Jamba Juice. And that makes a good life. Well, for some people, that's a start. Adam and Eve were created so that God's plan to bring into this world a relationship with him different from those who were angels, who are pure spirits. Spirits, angels, human beings and angels are not the same. Angels are pure spirit. They do not have any material component. They have a different relationship with God than human beings have. So every time I hear, aren't you an angel? And I have to ask families, do you allow your child to become an angel to be a fallen angel? Because every time, oh, he's a little angel. Well, I've seen a lot of little devils too. So you have to include the whole hierarchy of possibilities. Human beings are the only creation that can repent. And as human beings, we've been given something that is called free will. Angels have complete will, which is different. Angels, once they make a decision, can never repent. Even if given the opportunity, they would never take it. They're complete in their total will. Human beings can repent. And Adam and Eve were given an opportunity that God wished in their fall to seek the hope and promise. So what happens in the story of Adam and Eve? If you look at the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve were walking with God in the cool of the afternoon. God walked with his first pair of human beings. And they were to acquire knowledge, not to be entitled. You know, we've been hearing people think of, what am I entitled? Well, God is not an entitlement God. You don't get things from God because you deserve it. You have to enter into a right informed journey of having a true conscience and being formed to take responsibility. Freedom is not license. And this is where the seduction from Satan, because the first action the angels had, they never saw the face of God, but they were given the understanding that God would create a lower form of creature, but would be in God's image, and God would condescend to take the human form. And Satan immediately said, I am beautiful, I will not submit. So every angel that went with him, they never saw God's face. If they had seen God face to face, they would never have made that decision. A third of the angels fell through pride. So the first seduction is that it's contradiction. Sin is always contradictory. It's never complementary. You never have a sin that has or ever makes sense. It's always a contradiction to what is true. Adam and Eve were seduced because Adam and Eve resented being formed. They wanted from God what they thought they were entitled. That began before the dialogue, you see, by the tree of good and evil. So Adam and Eve together began to resent God because they did not want to be formed by God. They wanted to be self-complete. So when we have the fall, the contradiction is the two who work together all of a sudden split. And this is what always happens with sin. People always like to go together for their forbidden fruit, but once they receive it and get in trouble, boy, do people sing like canaries. Boy, do they split fast. The first sign that Adam and Eve were in contradiction is when they run from each other and hide. They don't even hide together. And when God calls out, he already knew what happened, but he's given them the opportunity to repent and to begin the healing process. So he calls out, and Adam says, well, we're hiding because we're naked. Who told you we're naked? And then all of a sudden, it's that woman. Whoa, man. She did it. And the woman said, well, you know, it's that serpent. So what does God do? He says, you know, I'm going to have to destroy you and start all over. No. In every culture that has the myth of fall and how sin came about, the gods who created always destroy. In the Mayan culture, humanity was destroyed 7 times before the gods felt they got it right. The Hebrew story is the only culture in which God does not destroy those who fall into sin. He gives a hope and promise. And the promise is, out of woman shall come the one who shall crush the head of the serpent and the one who will deliver. So what we have in the gift of St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, when he calls about Christ being born of woman, he's alluding back to the promise that humanity would be restored and would not be a contradiction any longer, that a true, full relationship with God is possible. We don't have to hide behind animal sacrifices. We don't have to look at contracts, because God never does in contracts. He does in covenant. But humanity always tried to have an intermediator as so they would not have to fully come to God. And Christ is the true Adam who restores that walk in the garden, and he has his Eve, which is his mother Mary, and they are what man and woman are supposed to be. They're not at odds with each other. You know, look at how society looks at men and women today. Everything's on power. Every comedy on television, prime time, always have men looking stupid. It's not to say that men don't do stupid things, but we don't do stupid things all the time. I'm sorry. And every woman is more powerful, and she knows better, even from the church. She knows better than the church. Well, if she knows better than the church, then she's God. And we don't have any goddesses among us. There's some people who try to be goddesses. But women should be who they're called to be. They're called to be women. We're to honor and cherish women. That's what Eve was supposed to do. Help us to cherish our calls and not be at odds with each other. Men should be proud of being men, and they should look at women, and they should honor women. Women should be proud to be women and not to be something they're not. Both men and women need to come together. That's why marriage can only be between a man and a woman. It can't be anything you want to make it, as society tries to do. Christ and his mother are journeying to what Adam and Eve abdicated, to restore and to acknowledge and to show us the will of the Father. You cannot be a true Christian if you do not do the will of the Father. And if you do not do the will of the Father, you can't honor Christ. And if you do not honor Christ by loving his mother, you're not in really on the true road. You're a contradiction. You're not in union. You don't have totality. Therefore, you can't have happiness. You can't have fulfillment. In my journey as a priest, It is not the issues of the failures of the church from its members that really disturb me, because we're going to have scandals until Christ calls us home. That's why his greatest attribute is mercy. If human beings were not affected by original sin, Christ would not have come in mercy, he would have come in judgment. He will come in judgment when we reject mercy. He revealed that to Sister Faustina. Call upon me in this life, and I'm a God of mercy. But if you reject my mercy and leave this world, you will receive me in justice, and I will judge. The call of Adam and Eve was to create an environment in which the Father could draw his children when they've been fully formed and completed, not to live in this world, but to be ready to be transformed into the kingdom of heaven. That's then the paradox about being human. We're pilgrims. We're not meant to take full residence in this world. We don't make a paradise of a material world. The material world is to guide us. So how we live as stewards of God's promise, how we recognize that we're not in control, God is. That's why we need to see how Mary reveals Christ's will in action. And women have a gift that men need in their lives. Women are the ones who show empathy better than any other human being. That's not to say that men can't be empathetic, but many times we lose our empathy to solve a problem, and women will say, wait a minute, have we thought about how this impacts a person? Are we looking at the feelings that the person's going through? That's why when I work in ministry with both men and women, it's a great joy because you get the gifts of both. And this is something that is beautiful. When a woman really lives out her call to nurture and to help bring growth in life, she doesn't look for the pat on the back. And a true man doesn't look for the pat on the back either. It's call of service and love. It's not, okay, I told you I could be a better priest than you. I never forget being involved in ministry in which I was working with a wonderful sister, but the sister had a challenge in her heart. Now, she never told this to my face, but every time we did ministry, we worked well together, but afterwards, she would tell the people, you know, I'd be a better priest than Father George. Maybe she could if she'd be a man. I don't doubt there are many women who are better at everything than I can do. But see, I wasn't in competition to say, you know, I'd probably be a better woman than she could. I mean, power plays is a contradiction. That's what happened with Adam and Eve. They had this split after they sinned. They had to go throughout the rest of their life trying to heal that split and prepare for that promise. And look what happened with their children. Cain and Abel is a direct result of their contradictory fight for I want to have it. It's entitled to me. Cain feels he's entitled. He works hard, and he feels that God should bless him because he's the eldest. Abel is blessed because he feels he's God's servant first, and that everything he has is a gift from God. If you and I work from the issue of I'm entitled, I deserve this, then we're really needing to know true stewardship and have a true role model. That's why in the early church, when people were considered entitlement, they were called children of Cain. Because the children of Cain always felt they were owed something. If you're ever with a person that always feels that they're entitled, you talk to them, oh, I'm Father involved in the church, and all of a sudden, I do this for the church, I do that for the church, and all you get is what they do for the church and what they think they're owed. That's a child of Cain. And if they don't get from God what they want, if they don't get the first prayer answered, I do everything for the church. God, why don't you hear my prayer? Well, God says, I have. You need something that you need that I'm giving out of love. You need to be humbled. Because God is not Monty Hall. He doesn't have three doors. Which one do you want? That's the devil. The devil is Monty Hall. Not the real Monty Hall, of course. And you know what? The devil always collects what he wants. You know what, Monty Hall, you always had the one door that had the donkey. Well, the devil makes sure each door has a donkey. You think you're getting something good, and then you end up with something that has no value. But when you look at the role of Mary, what does she do? Well, first of all, in every Marian moment, it reflects to a Christ moment. They work together. So when we look at the Annunciation draws us back to the walk that God wanted to have with Adam and Eve, to teach and to prepare. So when the angel Gabriel, that is the angel that drove Adam and Eve out of the garden, and that's the angel that guarded Eden until the incarnation, so that no one could go back to the garden. Gabriel becomes the messenger because Gabriel was there at the moment humanity fell. Gabriel is the angel of the incarnation. He's the angel of Mary, and he's, by many traditions, he's considered the guardian angel of Christ, and when he was in this world under his human nature. Gabriel announces, and Mary says what Eve should have said, "Be it done unto me according to your word." Mary didn't say, "Wait a minute. What? Oh, really? Well, who's going to protect my reputation? You better tell my mom. And what do I get out of this? And what about that man Joseph?" You know, and I have to tell you this, because this is connected. Joseph did not believe Mary had a relationship with a man. Joseph could not comprehend that he could be worthy of entering into the mystery. Joseph did not want to abandon Mary because he thought less of her. He could not comprehend that he would be the foster father of the Son of God. That is by Saint Jerome and by most of the church fathers. We've gotten it wrong. We've had movies where Joseph thinks, who did I end up connecting with? Even in the movie Jesus of Nazareth, which is my favorite Christ movie, you know, we get Joseph having the wrong thought. Joseph did not doubt Mary. He could not consider himself worthy of being with the one who was called to be the true Eve, because he knew that there was a mystery that was beyond his comprehension. But look what happened in the call of Mary and Joseph. They come together and they don't hide from one another, they deal with one another. And Joseph takes up his call as given by the angel, and he walks and journeys with Mary. Now, this is what man and woman are supposed to do in the call of marriage. And this is what Adam and Eve were called to help us to understand of becoming one, which is the most beautiful gift in the sacrament of marriage, that the two become one and help to build holy families so that we can enter the kingdom of God. Mary's fiat is the greatest and most humble yes ever given. And Mary never expects to be treated with special consideration. That's why if you're reading these mystical stories where Mary never washed diapers, that she just sat and prayed all day and there were angels doing all the housework, get rid of those books. That's not to say that the people weren't sincere, but they're wrong. Mary did not have exemptions from wrinkles and from other challenges. She is without sin, but she lived in the world. She got calluses. She had to go through hunger moments. You know, the Father in heaven didn't say, "Oh, yeah, you're carrying my son. Oh, you'll always have Omaha steaks waiting for you." We do that to Mary. We do that. We act like Jesus, Mary, and Joseph were play actors on a stage. That's what early heresies would do. Well, they only pretended to be one of us. They had a different life. Don't you know that? Send me $500 and I'll tell you the true story. They had that in Gnosticism. Long before Benny Hinn and others, it was already done. If you want to know the truth, come over here and I'll tell you the truth. But it's going to cost you 500 denarius because it pays to have the truth. Well, the church shares with us freely. Mary, in her journey of the Annunciation, Mary was informed before her moment by her parents, Joachim and Anne. Mary was dedicated. Mary lived in preparation. This is what Eve was called to do. Christ in the womb is journeying within his mother, the ark. And when Christ comes into the world, he begins the journey that Adam was supposed to have. Christ is called to reveal the Father's will in all his actions. Adam was given that vocation, and Adam abdicated from it. But here's the beauty of this journey. Our first parents are not written out of the story. And in the Eastern Church, Adam and Eve have a feast day. It's December 24th during the daytime. That's why you have Christmas trees. The tree, the fir tree, which is the sign of eternal life. The ornament that is red, which is usually apples in the north, in the Germanic lands, as a sign of perpetual fruit that's always there. It also reminds them of the tree of good and evil. The candle, which is the light of Christ to come, and the star, which represents Mary's call to be the mother of God, Maris Stella, star of the sea. So, in the Eastern Church, Adam and Eve are known as saints, and they are seen in the icon of the resurrection. In the East, they never show the empty tomb. In the East, if you want to know what the resurrection looks like, it's Jesus descending into the Old Testament hell, which is the abode of the dead, and the first persons he encounters are Adam and Eve as he breaks the gates of death. That is the role that Mary and Jesus walked together with, to break the gates of hell and to show that the kingdom of God is eternal. And it's our choice by the gift of free will to enter into it. But we need to be rightly informed. That's why we need our church. We're a part of the church. We journey with the church. But we're not more knowledgeable than the church. And as Catholic Christians, we should love our church, even when members fail. Would it be something if God, when we stand before the kingdom, says, you know, you're a member of my church, but you know, I don't like you. You know, I don't know if I want you with me for all eternity, but Heavenly Father, you're supposed to love me and part of the church. Well, I don't like you. When we criticize Holy Mother Church and think that we're better, then we are criticizing God, because God established the church. When Jesus said unto Peter, you are the rock and the gates of hell shall not prevail, he's talking truly. He knew Peter was weak, but Peter will become transformed, because Peter listened and he grew and he repented and he redirected. He became right informed in his conscience, and he chose the fullness of eternal life. This is so important for the day, because we're at a pivotal point in our church journey. Many times when I have people ask me about politics, and you don't have to ask me much, because I used to work on political campaigns. Before I became wanting to become a priest, I was involved with the Democratic Party in my home state of Kentucky, and I worked for many local campaigns. It was a good experience, and I think everyone should have a civic experience. But as a Roman Catholic, I always have to realize I have to put my church's teachings as the proof of whether or not a campaign I work for. I don't believe in what I've been hearing from some theologians. You don't have to support his abortion part. Support the things you like. Well, I've never heard anything like that. And I've had some people come and say, you know, Father, I can support this candidate because I don't like his abortion, but I love his health care. Okay, well, good. You love his health care, but what's a part of his health care? Abortion. So are you going to stand for the whole package? Well, no, I don't want to be judged on that part. Well, you will be when you stand before God. You have to make a commitment. You take the whole truth or you reject the whole truth. You don't take parts of the truth. God doesn't allow that. Now, sometimes that makes God a party pooper. And when people get angry at the church, they're really angry at God. I wish they'd just be honest about it. Don't say you're angry at the cardinal or this cardinal or that priest or that bishop. You can have personal disagreements with persons. But if you don't like a teaching from the church, be honest, say, I don't like what God has asked me to do. And don't beat around the bush. Mary and Jesus are never contradictory, and they don't speak in doublespeak. They speak only in the truth, and the truth is a two-edged sword. And it's not always comfortable to hear. And it's not always easy to live. So when the early church called Mary the true Eve, they were saying is that Mary chose the arduous journey to reveal the will of the Father in union with Adam, which is Jesus. And so we have in all the church fathers, they always have this relationship with Mary, they very seldom use her name. But she's always known as the Lady. She's known as the True Eve. She's known as the Mother of Christ. And in fact, in the Eastern Church, many times they won't use the name of Mary because they reverence it so much, they will only use the term Our Lady. And then they give the title of the devotion to Our Lady. But Mary always leads us a mother. The first Christian art to show us to Jesus was not a figure of Jesus in his full form we have today. The picture of Jesus that we have with the beard, which I love, comes from a 5th century icon from the Sinai Monastery of St. Catherine. It's the first image, and it came from the shroud as it was passing through that area. And the monks there, in encaustic wax, made the first image of Jesus with the beard from the shroud. What was the images of Jesus before? Well, the first image of putting Jesus in his human form is him nursing in his mother's breast. Mary was 40 times more likely to be depicted on the catacombs than Jesus was. They had the symbols of Jesus, the anchor, the cross, the young shepherd, the pelican, which represents Christ as head of the church. The church nurtures its members. But it was Mary, always from the very beginning, from the first century, Mary was always depicted, and she's always depicted as the True Eve. That's why when we talk about Christ born of woman, it's not a detriment to us as followers of Christ. It is something to give us hope, because only Mary knows how to fully follow Jesus in his complete journey. And we are to follow an example. She gives us hope. She is a true mother. When we look at her when she's called queen, in the ancient world, queens were not the wife of the king, the mother of the king. And a queen could only become queen when her son was elected, and she was the intermediary. You didn't go and make an audience with the king. You had to go through the mother. Now, there are some families who think, well, I have a mother-in-law like that. And it can be, that's not doing the way Mary did it, but that's how queens did. Queens were there to bring people to the reality of the king and his authority. Mary is never in competition with Jesus. If you look at all the scriptural references, it is Mary that always says, do what he tells you, like in the beautiful account of the wedding feast at Cana. It was always the mother that made sure that everyone was well taken care of. Now, the good thing about weddings at that time, the bride and the groom had to give everyone gifts. They didn't get gifts. Because you didn't get married unless you could show that you were wealthy enough to splurge. The mother made sure that everyone got what they deserved. So the bride had to make wedding garments for every guest, along with her own trousseau. The man had to build the house, provide the wax for the candles, and make sure there were enough slaughtered cattle for everyone to be well fed, and the wine better be first choice. So what they would do is get people drunk really quickly with the good stuff, and then get the cheapest, nastiest Annie Spring Farm Boone's Night Train 2020 you can find. But what does Mary do? She goes, she doesn't say, you know, you are my son and I'm going to look bad. Because see, Mary was related to the couple. Jesus related. And Mary says they have no wine. Now she doesn't whine about it. And he says, what does this have to do with me? My time has not yet come. Mary does not force Jesus, but what Jesus allows his mother to do is to intercede. And what does she do? She doesn't say, well, no, that's fine. I had you in my womb for 9 months. I had to worry what people thought how you were conceived. And, you know, Joseph really wasn't there for everything. So fine. What's it used to be your mother? No, she says, do whatever he tells you. And Jesus acts with humility and love to do the will of the Father. And what happens is we have a foreshadowing of what is the greatest gift we have, the Mass. Mary is involved in each step to reveal how to enter the kingdom of the Father by the will of Jesus, who is in human form showing the Father. Remember what Jesus says, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So how can we as Catholic Christians then grow in our journey? Well, first of all, we need to, with humility, say that we're created and that we are to be informed. We need true catechesis. You need to ask out of your priest, your religious lay leaders, and you need to encourage your bishops to be authentic ministers of the church's teachings. Please ask of that. You don't have to be rude about it. You don't have to be strident. But everyone deserves to know the truth. The greatest injustice and the most merciless act a person can do is to tell a lie and make it look compassionate. It does not help any of us to have half-truth or no truth. We need the full truth. Mary is never a person of a lie. Mary only reveals the truth. Second of all, we need to ask ourselves, how do we serve the church and not feel entitled to receive from the church? If you're in ministry, I bless you for that. But if you're looking for compliments because you're in ministry, you know what? I hope God gives you the greatest gift he can give you, true humility. I don't want humiliation. There's a difference. But every one of us are dispensable. There's always someone out there who can do a better job than any of us. The fact that we do ministry is because we are called to serve. We want to reveal the kingdom in action now. So that means we have to have a true understanding of how we're to live. And that's why having the devotion to Mary, praying the rosary reverently, not reciting the rosary. Believe me, I've been to many Kentucky Derby of the rosaries. There should be some cups out there to some rosary groups. I know that you're under gun if you're trying to pray the rosary before Mass begins, because a rosary should not be in competition with the Mass. That's why in some parishes, you either start real early and so you have time to finish before Mass begins, or you pray after the Mass. It's a good way to do your act of thanksgiving. But when you pray the rosary, you should meditate on it, because Mary always pondered and treasured. If you ask any iconographer, the most visible sign of Mary is she has a small mouth. She has the perfect small mouth. Mary is not a loud mouth. I got to learn more from Mary, don't I? Mary doesn't say more than she has to, and she doesn't say less than necessary. She says the right, perfect amount. Mary ponders and treasures within her heart. Do we meditate and make our own what has been revealed to us? Do we really take time to know the mysteries? And please remember, not every mystery will be fully revealed. We're not placing mysteries under microscopes. That is why Mother Teresa said the West is so impoverished, because you expect to see under a microscope what God sees in the heart. You can't dissect a deed of mercy. You can't dissect an action of good. And we shouldn't try to have every ounce of understanding. That's why I love parents. True moms and dads are always mystified by their children. They don't try to say, oh, I know you. They know that they are you, that you come from them, and that you're a gift. But anyone that tries to take ownership of another and how they do things isn't looking at mystery. So God says to us, I want you as my children to choose me freely. And that's why Mary is such a role model, because Mary gives her yes, because she takes time to ponder and treasure. She's not hasty, and she's not a procrastinator. So what is Jesus in his role with his mother? How is that something that impacts? Well, Jesus wants Mary to be a mediatrix, to intercede, and to bring us through the fullness of truth. She is not in competition for the glory. It's always wonderful that the Father, in his wisdom of sending his Son into the world, gave the most complimentary and most beautiful gift to his Son, a mother who is always willing to give glory to her Son. In that call, we don't have to worry that we're paying too much honor to Mary. And that is why when we talk to those who do not understand our devotion to Mary, it's very important to know how the saints have lived it. John, who was put in charge of taking care of Mary, how beautiful at the scene of the cross, woman, behold your son, and then turning to John, son, behold your mother, which tells you that Jesus was Mary's only son. Because even if she had half brothers and sisters, some people believe that she had other children. Joseph had other children. This tells you that Joseph stayed a virgin all his life because he did not have half children. Jesus had cousins, but they weren't in a charge or authority. It had to be a brother, a brother-in-law, or a son. Mary is put into care of John. John's a cousin of Jesus, and John is a virgin. He complements their call together, and Mary allows herself to enter into John's life, and she loves all the apostles, and she will share with them, and John will care for Mary, and that continues the role that Adam and Eve was to give, to come together to give what the other needed to make them a complete and whole. So in our journey to really show to our brothers and sisters who are afraid that we give too much honor to Mary is to see how Christ himself honored his mother, how the Father reverenced and honored Mary in her journey. And we need to take that up and not be ashamed of it. We don't need to give apologies for devotions to Mary. I'll never forget Father Steve Burnham being asked by a person, why do you worship Mary? He said, because we want to. And this year we're worshiping banners, not statues. Because people have those idiotic ideals. And then he would sit down. He was a former evangelical, and he's been a former a lot of things, you know, God rest his soul. But he could talk and would be invited by Assembly of God people to talk on Mary. Why? Because he didn't apologize and make excuses for what is a part of our Christian journey. He didn't try to say, well, you know, it's those Catholics, we just have to follow it. He saw that he had an opportunity to show what they are lacking. And you know, there are many Protestant communities that have now added devotion to Mary as a part of their journey. Many Anglican communities started praying the rosary. That's why many of them are leaving the Episcopal and Anglican Church and coming connected with us, because they began to have a renewal of devotion to Mary, and Mary's bringing Anglicans into the Roman Catholic Church. God be praised. And we welcome our brothers and sisters. Some of the first advocates for Medjugorje were Protestants. And there's a Protestant pastor that wrote about praying the rosary and about his devotion to Mary. And you know, that's not an easy thing to do, because you lose your reputation quite quickly if you get too close to Mary. Why is it then that we who are children of Mary are afraid as Catholics to show our true devotion? That doesn't mean that we become fanatics, because Mary would never want that. But to be fulfilled as a Christian, we have to have the course of Adam and Eve working together. Our first parents abdicated their authority that was given because they didn't want to be trained and have a right informed conscience. They wanted to be entitled. But Jesus and his mother, our mother, they are in service to us. God condescends to his children in a beautiful way. So I pray that you will have a place in your home where you have a beautiful image of Our Lady that you reverence and honor. And please make Christ the center of your faith journey. Get a copy, a working copy of the Universal Catechism of the Catholic Church. Our Holy Father is asking during this year of faith that we have a working Bible, that we get a true, usable catechism, and start reading and studying. Place a family altar or prayer center in your home and consecrate that home to Jesus the King and Mary as Queen. And I tell you this, you will never regret it. If you've seen the movie Greater Glory, and I would just counsel everyone to do that, because it's going to happen in this country fairly soon, whether we believe it or not. In Greater Glory, the martyrs who could stay true to the church were the ones who had devotion to Mary and Jesus the King. That's why Viva Cristo Rey and Viva la Reina de Guadalupe were together. 85 martyrs were in that movie being represented. One was a 12-year-old boy. He was wearing a medallion of Our Lady. His mother let her 12-year-old son go to join the Cristeros. Jose Sanchez del Rio who was a true saint, he was canonized by Pope Benedict, died at the age of 12 in front of his parents, as the movie says, by a horrible death. But he died with Viva Cristo Rey, Viva la Guadalupe. I hope that you can honor, maybe not in the martyrdom that he had, but in the daily life that you are called. If you want to help the church in this year of faith, and you want the church to fulfill her call, please be advocates of devotion to Our Lady and Our Lord in the right sense, and be loyal to our Holy Mother, the Catholic Church. I apologize for the shortcoming of clergy. I have many of my own. Just recently, I saw an article about a priest I knew who was a year behind me who embezzled money from an elderly woman. In my heart, I thought I couldn't get more dealing with scandals, and then you find one that just really rips your heart out. But the good thing that came out of this is I began to pray anew, first for the victim, but to pray for the man who became victimized because he was seduced. I knew him as a man who reverenced the poor and honored them. I knew him as a one who prayed the rosary every day and went before the Blessed Sacrament and devoted his life for the needs of others. And somewhere down the line, he didn't finish that journey and he became seduced. And I pray as he's stripped, because he will be, and he goes through all the pain and anguish that he will have to, that he comes back in the arms of the true Adam and the true Eve, so that he does not lose his eternal soul. And I pray for the mother and her family that they will not write off the church because of one person they trusted but who failed. We can be sons and daughters of Adam and Eve who are on the journey of salvation, or we can be contradictions to the call of humanity and end up being seduced. It's up to us. I hope we all choose the path to eternal salvation. Let us end with a prayer. Let us pray the Memorare. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to your protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, we fly unto you, O virgins of virgins, our mother. To we do we stand, to we do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O most holy Mother of God. I hope I got it right. Sometimes my mind wanders. But the Memorare was given to us by St. Bernard of Clairvaux, who has been called the Apostle of Mary from the Middle Ages, and he brought his whole family are canonized. There are over 300 members of his family that are canonized by the church. Wouldn't that be something? He brought 30 of them into the first monastery he entered at the age of 18. See what Mary can do. God bless you. Become a saint, and then pray for me to become one.
This presentation has been recorded by the SCRC Ministry. All rights are reserved.